Hi guys, Addis here. In today's video, I want to talk about a very serious subject that concerns PSU protection features. This is the latest ATX spec, version 3.1. AC input required. Whatever is required by the ATX spec, you need it. If there's something else that it isn't required, it says recommended. The correct input range for use in each environment may be either switch. Okay, it tells basically in the US, the mains is 115 volt AC. In Europe and China, 230 volt AC. In Japan, 100 volt AC. In Brazil, both 115 and 230 volt. This is the worst case scenario. In AC input, we have a table here. The ATX spec says minimum 90 volt, nominal 115, maximum 135 for the 115 volt AC. For 230 volt AC mains, it says minimum 180, nominal 230, maximum 265. Okay, the note here says nominal voltages for test purposes are considered to be within plus minus 1 volt of nominal. This means that whenever we test, we take efficiency or ripple or whatever readings, we have to be either 114 or 116 maximum, or 229 or 231 maximum. This is what I want you to look at. Because there are some talk lately about under voltage protection, input under voltage protection. So the ATX spec clearly says the power supply must be able to start up under full loading at 90V AC. It doesn't say that it has to keep up the full load, for how long it has to keep the full load. It doesn't say if it will blow or something else. It only states the obvious, that it has to start up, nothing else. Not the time, not the period that it has to sustain the full load. Neither it says how long it will live under full loading at 90 volt AC. And some of you might say, hey, Addis, yeah, it goes without saying that the PSU has to live this test, has to survive this test. No, guys. From the moment it doesn't state a specific period that the PSU has to sustain full load under 90 volt AC, everything else is clearly an assumption. It's not a fact. The fact here is that it says the power supply must be able to start up under full loading at 90 volt AC. Personally, I don't agree at all with this, especially with the full loading part. From the moment, the power specifications in most PSUs, at least, okay, I don't want to say all because there must be some that go out of this rule, clearly state VAC input 100 volt to 240. Clearly, they clearly state that the power specifications, that it is from 100 volt to 240. If you fully load the PSU at 90 volt AC, you are clearly out of the specifications that the manufacturer provides. It is like me flying a plane where the stall speed is 45 knots and I go with 40 knots, I fly at 40 knots and the plane stalls and it falls down and I get killed. And I say, in the afterlife, I don't know, why this happened? Because the manufacturer state that the stall speed is 45 knots. And I went with 40, so it is natural that the plane flew down to the ground. When you get a PSU, you have to follow the HUD specifications. A specification like the input voltage, it's a HUD specification. You cannot ignore that. And, okay, some of you will tell me, hey, Addis, what about the brownouts and stuff like that? In most countries, there are no brownouts. For example, go to Germany, go to mainland Greece, mainland, not the island, US. And I will tell you another thing. Okay, let's say there is a brownout. You will run the PSU at full load during the brownout. How much chance there is in such a scenario? Usually, the power supply operates at full load. It depends, of course, on the system and the PSU itself. But let's say that you have a 1000 watt PSU. When you will fully load this PSU? Most of the time, most of their operational time, PSUs operate at typical loads of around 50 to 100 watt idle, desktop idle, even lower than that. The chance to have a PSU at full load during a brownout, it's minimal. And on top of that, if you are so afraid of brownouts, for example, in my island, Lesbos, where we frequently had brownouts and stuff like that, I bought a UPS or a line conditioner. Specifically, I had a UPS. And the UPS was connected all the time to the PSU. Whenever there was a problem, the AVR, automatic voltage regulator on the UPS, handled the situation. And if the situation was too extreme, the battery of the UPS took over. And the PSU had a stable input, 230 volt in this case. So if you live in an area where the mains grid is totally unstable, so unstable, go buy an UPS. Because the UPS device is the one that will save you. You cannot blame the PSU if it blows up or something goes wrong when it takes 90 volt AC only and at the same time it applies full load. And you cannot also tell that, hey, that is not what the ATX spec says, because the ATX spec clearly says that the PSU must be only able to start up under full loading, nothing else. It doesn't define the load period. It doesn't define the operational temperature. It doesn't define what the PSU will do after this test is finished. Nothing. Another thing I want you to check here, input under voltage. The power supply is required to contain protection circuitry such that the application of an input voltage below the minimum specified in Table 4.1, that and that, shall not cause damage to the power supply. What this means? It means that, for example, if I apply 80 volt AC input in a PSU, we don't care about the load, we don't care about anything here, the PSU should not get damaged. I don't care if the PSU will operate, most likely it won't even start, okay, with only 80 volt. I don't care about the load, it doesn't say anything about the load. So let's assume that I take a PSU, I jump start it, and I use only 80 volt AC input. The PSU should not be damaged. If I tried it again with 115 or 230 volt, the PSU should start. It should not get damaged with a very low VAC. The ATX spec clearly says that the PSU should be okay after the test, shall not cause damage to the power supply. The ATX spec is the Bible of PSUs, if I can call it like that. Whatever it says, normally it's the law. Whether we agree with that or not. Personally, I don't agree with the 90 volt rule or the 180 volt rule, because the power specs clearly says, clearly put some inputs. Okay, the 180, you can say from the moment the power specifications label says from 100 to 240, you can include that. But the power specification label starts from 100 volt. It doesn't go any lower than that. Check here, be quiet, power zone. AC input, 100 to 240 volt AC. It doesn't say 90 anywhere, it says 100. This is the Tecnam plane that I learned how to fly. Stall speed, flaps down, 39 knots. If you go any lower, imagine what will happen. That's a hard specification, guys. That's a hard specification. You cannot ignore a hard specification. Despite all of that, we decided to make a special load station to try out 90 volt AC. So far we went to 100 volt AC because that's the lowest that the power specifications label says. We did run also some tests at 90 volt, but from now on, in some PSUs, from now on, we will check all power supplies at 90 volt AC, and we intend to do so for 5 minutes at least load. Normal room temperature, not 40 or 45 degrees, because this is not defined. Neither the period is defined. The spec, as I've mentioned several times so far, it says the PSU to start up at full load with 90 volt AC. That is all, nothing else. We will run this test, and we will also run a test with 80 volt AC to check if the PSU will get damaged. We don't care if the PSU will start, probably won't start, we don't care about that. We only care if the PSU will get destroyed. We with 80 volt AC. If we do all operate again, if we apply a normal voltage input, we are going to include EMI testing. I did EMI testing before for, remember, in some of the Views Tech Power Up for Tom's Hardware for a period of time. I don't know why, because of the move of the lab, because I had so much other stuff going on, I stopped testing EMI. We start again EMC, pre-compliance testing. Every PSU will have an EMI report from now on from us. For me, EMI, EMC pre-compliance is very, very important, much more important than the highly unlikely scenario of low AC input, as I explained. In general, three new tests from now on, and we're going to do way, way more. All testing follows the ISO 17025 guidelines, and we also recently applied for certification body under the ISO 17065, which is a completely different level. If you have any comments, leave them. In general, I want you to understand that we are pushing everybody, manufacturers, brands, everybody, to improve their products. But on the other hand, we have to be a little bit careful there, because whoever sends products to us does so by his own will. We cannot force anybody, a brand or a manufacturer, to send us products. And we also cannot force anyone to listen to us. In many, many cases and products, we have made suggestions, but it is up to the factory, up to the brand, up to the manufacturer, if he will follow these suggestions that we made or not. What provides strength to us is you, the people, the users. Only with your support we can move forward and apply more pressure to the manufacturers to improve their products. This is what I want you all to understand. So we want you by our side. And believe me, we are on your side. That is how it goes. So thank you. Bye-bye.